Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship service here at First Baptist and to our family. By the way of the internet, we welcome you, too. Yes, the prelude was take time to be holy. Am I right, Abby? Yes. And that's what we need to do in our lives is take time to be holy. Speak off with thy Lord. Now, Pastor is doing a series in Philippians, and I have a couple questions for him. Pastor, can I get you to stand up? He gives me that look like I'm in trouble. You're not in trouble. You're bigger than me. As I was reading through the book of Philippians, I noticed that one word kind of got repeated again and again and again. Does anybody know what that word is? It's two letters, in, I-N. So I thought, well, I'll count it. And the reason I'm counting it is because when I looked at my commentary that I use, Daily Bible Studies series by William Barclay, do you know that one?
Yeah,
it's a pretty good one. Well, he said the Apostle Paul uses the word in quite a few times, but I counted 63 times the word in is used in Philippians, okay? Now, what does the word in mean? Well, the commentary said that the Apostle Paul uses the word in Christ Jesus, or in the Lord different times. He uses it 48 times in his writing of in Christ Jesus. In Christ, 34 times. In the Lord, 50 times. Now, the question is, how can I be in Christ? We are in the sanctuary, Pastor, right? But then he says, in Christ. And if you notice, the first three chapters in Philippians all have a word. And in chapter 1, it says, in Christ. In chapter 2, the first verse says, chapter 1 says, in Christ Jesus. Chapter 2 says, in Christ. And chapter 3 says, in the Lord. Now, how can I be in the building or in the sanctuary, but also at the same time be in the Lord? Tough question?
That's a good question. Part of what we're talking about today.
So your message is partakers
of grace.
Of grace or yeah. In grace? Can we use in or of?
Probably would apply this similarly, yeah. Partakers of grace, partakers in grace, sure. Paul says partakers of grace.
Partakers of grace, okay. So, did the kids know what the word partakers mean? Our young folks? Maybe you're going to have to explain that to us, Pastor, if you would, please.
There we go. I'll get yelled at by the teachers and say it means to take part.
Okay.
Not allowed to use the same words in the definition, right?
I didn't know that.
Well, we're excited as we come to worship the Lord together, and certainly it's been a fun time studying together as we've gone through Philippians these past couple of weeks, and we'll be continuing there today. But as we prepare for that, I'm going to invite you to stand this morning for a call to worship from Psalm 98. If you would, stand. Psalm 98 says, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into song and sing praises." Let's begin our service time this morning in doing that as the worship team comes forward and we begin our time of singing together with hymn number 435, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus."
continuing in our singing, turn to hymn number 88 as we sing Fairest Lord Jesus. Last Wednesday, we had a special night for our Wednesday night prayer meeting. Special in the sense that it was a little different than what we normally do. But the Lord has really laid on my heart that our church right now, there are just a number of things going on in our midst that are heavy. There's some heavy things taking place here in our lives, both individually and also as a body of believers here as we look towards some coming things for us as a church family. And so we dedicated almost a whole hour, would you believe that, to just praying together. And we prayed and lifted our requests before the Lord. And I was encouraged that night that, as we've said throughout a number of studies we've done now, the work is really done in prayer, that as we lift up our requests before the Lord, as we pray together, that God hears our prayers, and that there is something special about when we can come together and do it here or elsewhere. But when we're together and we're praying, lifting up those requests, certainly we can do it privately, but God is glorified when His people come together as the body of Christ and pray. And so this morning, we're going to continue in that. I invite you to bow with me for a word of prayer, and we'll have some quiet moments where you can pray individually, and then I'm going to close us with a word of prayer. But let's be encouraged this morning of the power of this room, empowered by the Holy Spirit. As we lift up our requests before the Lord, God is working through those prayers, and Christ is actively interceding on our behalf. Let's pray together. Lord, our hearts come before you this morning. And for so many of us, we come broken. God, it has been a really difficult season for us as we've dealt with hard news, Father, hard diagnoses, Father, losses. Lord, the weight of this world and the sin that's present everywhere we look, sometimes it causes our hearts just to fall to ash. Lord, we are a body of believers here that you've brought together by the bond that we have in Jesus Christ. And so we come before you earnestly seeking your favor, your hand, your guidance, your direction, your comfort. Lord, as we labor here, we know that things are hard, but we also know that Christ said, "Let not your hearts be troubled." When we face these circumstances, Lord, let that be the refrain that echoes through our souls, that we might remember, because of the work of Christ, our hearts don't have to be troubled because he has gone on to prepare a place for us. And oh Lord, that's our hope. It's all we've got. Our hope rests firmly in the finished work of Jesus Christ. And we know that even now, that as we come before you, he is actively interceding on our behalf, protecting that which you have given to us. And we praise you. Lord, as we come together this morning, may our hearts be those who desire to be molded and shaped by you. Lord, might there be unity here in our midst. Might we not try to cut one another off at the knees, but instead come together earnestly desiring that we might be co-laborers, partakers in grace for the work of the gospel. Oh Lord, thank you. Thank you for this time. Might you be glorified in us as we give you all the glory. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, at this time, I invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. And you can stand as we prepare for the reading of the word together. You'll remember last week we studied one verse, Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. And today we're taking the next five verses, verses 7 through 11, but I think it would be good for us to start in verse 6. And so we're going to start there this morning. It says, "And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all because I hold you in my heart, for you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I yearn for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God." Blessed be the word of the Lord. As we prepare to further receive it this morning, let us sing together in remembrance for our desperate need for our Savior. Hymn number 428, "I Need Thee Every Hour." Your word now this morning, we pray that you would speak to our hearts cause for your words alone to stand, to resonate in our hearts as we desire to become more and more like you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Well, as we begin this morning, as I mentioned earlier, you'll remember we're coming off of a study last week that really brought for us a pretty neat encouragement from the Apostle Paul in expressing his love for his fellow brothers and sisters in Philippi. He undergirded their ministry with an inspired message of God's enduring work in his people. That no one can take that which God has given you. Recently, during our study in 1 Peter on Wednesday nights, we talked about how it says that God is really the, and we kind of used a term that maybe we would understand now, an analogy, but he is the bodyguard for our faith. Nobody's getting through, right? He protects that which he has given us. And we can be encouraged in that because we know then there's nothing that can happen here on earth that can steal that which God has given to his children. As Paul wrote with these encouraging words to the people in Philippi, he reminds us time and time again, and will continue to do so, of the love that he had for those people and his desire to see them stand firm in their faith. As I said, this letter, it has a little bit of a different tone to it, because a number of letters, as we read through, there's a little bit of chastisement that goes on. Specifically, our minds point to Corinthians. But here in this letter, there's a lot more encouragement. The tone's a little different here. Paul's not so much correcting them as he is encouraging them to press on, to be encouraged by the work that God is doing, no matter what we see on the outside in the world around us. And so what greater encouragement for us this morning could there be than to assure us that as we press on, the work that Christ started will indeed be brought to a full completion. That he is working even now on our behalf, interceding for us. The pain that the people in Philippi, the believers, were suffering, and the trials that came with serving the Lord were not done in vain. And so is that true of us today. As we serve the Lord, we can be encouraged that the work that we're doing, that God is empowering us to do, is not being done in vain. In fact, it's being noticed in real time by our God. And the God-given gift of endurance is the means by which the Holy Spirit works to ensure the delivery of you and I to our Savior one day. What a blessed hope we have in knowing that our labors are not in vain. God will bring our salvation to completion. He will do it. He who has saved you is faithful to do that. And for us, as we deal with difficult circumstances, times of uncertainty, times of pain, times of trial, what an encouragement that the God who started a work in you will bring it to completion. And so we come to our verses this morning with that in mind. Philippians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, where Paul says, "It is right for me to feel this way about you all because I hold you in my heart. For you are all partakers with me of grace." Hence the sermon title this morning. both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I yearn for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. You know, we said Paul held a special place in his heart for these people in Philippi. There was a special enduring work that God did in their bond together. They went through a lot in their ministry as brothers and sisters in Christ. And as Paul continues here, he explained to the Philippian believers that it was right for him to feel the way that he feels about them. There was, in fact, no other way for Paul to feel towards the ones who were tied to him with the spiritual unity of the bond of Jesus Christ. And they together, though separate, Paul says here that they are all partakers of grace. Partakers of grace. They, along with Paul, walked the same path, just with different circumstances. They went through different trials, but man, there was an enduring work that was beyond anything that they could have created with their human hands. They were joined together with their common salvation, and though the trials they experienced were different, as Paul wrote to them, remember, he did it from prison, but that was not something he said or endured simply to bring on pity or have some sense of superiority. In the midst of his agonizing circumstances, Paul was reminded that there were people in other places who were on the same mission. And man, that was an encouragement to him. It was encouraging to him as he received their gift from, does anybody remember who? Starts with an E. Epaphroditus. Baby name. All right, we'll stick with Fannie Fae. As Paul received that gift, he was reminded that there are people who were still praying for him, who were laboring for the gospel, though they themselves were not in chains as he was. And as Paul dealt with all that came from being an outcast in prison, he was encouraged that the mission of God continued. You know, I, just a couple weeks ago, was encouraged by a video, and there's actually a movie, we may be talking about it more in the weeks to come, and if you have interest, I would recommend, I still need to watch it, but I know a lot of the backstory on it. It's called Essential Church, and it talks about the persecution that the church experienced, and I don't think we have to be half-hearted about using that word there, during the pandemic. And there was a video that was shown, not in the Essential Church movie, but separately, of a pastor who was taken from his family because he refused to stop having church when the world, when Satan tried to bring the church to its knees. And as the police car drove this man away, he said to his family, Christ will build his church. That was his message to his family. Christ will build his church. And as I thought about that, I thought about the Apostle Paul. And as he wrote to the people in Philippi, as he was shackled up in prison, I have to imagine those similar words were on his heart. Christ will build his church. Doesn't matter where we are the things we're dealing with, Christ's work continues. And that's something that our hearts should really get excited about, that everything we endure, Christ is still building his church. We can often lose sight of the grand picture of what is taking place in God's church, both locally and worldwide. We as a church are blessed to be able to take part in supporting a number, pretty big number, of missionaries worldwide. We've heard stories from many of them, and actually, the next couple of months, you're going to be hearing some more from a number of our missionaries that are going to be coming through here. But they're serving the same God that we are, yet experiencing it differently with circumstances we can't understand, hardships that we can't understand. And while many of them have it harder than we do, the reality is then they can't really fully understand what we deal with here. We can't always understand what our brothers and sisters are experiencing across the globe, but the reality is Christ is still building his church. The work of the gospel continues. I'm often reminded of my grandmother, who used to say, they lived in Philadelphia, and she used to say, you know, hey, when you get home, when we leave the pool in my grandparents' house, when we look up at the moon, we're looking at the same moon. That's kind of a wild thought. I don't know if you've ever thought about that. You and I, even when it gets to be nighttime and we look up, though we're apart, we're looking at the same moon. But how much more so is it true that as we serve in different places throughout the world for the sake of Christ, we serve the same God and his purposes? God's work continues. He uses us in different ways, and as we serve, we are reminded that we are all indeed partakers of grace. But God's work does not stop, and Paul surely knew this. And be sure, I don't believe that this is him saying that, hey, while I'm in prison, I'm not doing any ministry. You guys keep up the good work. I don't think that's what he's saying at all, but I think his heart was encouraged because he knew that as he served in prison, his brothers and sisters were serving elsewhere, and they hadn't forgotten about him. They hadn't forgotten about him. They all had a special bond. They were partakers of grace. That is to say that each day we are reminded of the abundant gift of salvation that we have been given and the hope of salvation that permeates our lives. Paul had gone through so much, yet he and the Philippians, well, they continued to stay firm for the sake of the gospel, and that comforted Paul's heart immensely. You know, I think we often forget what an encouragement we can be to one another as we labor together for the gospel ministry. That sometimes our arms, our legs, they get a little weak. We need each other, that example. And I think for Paul here, as he recounted the work that was persisting in Philippi, he was encouraged. Man, God is still doing a marvelous work. As Paul stood before Roman officials and proclaimed his great salvation, as he stood largely alone and continued to defend and make known a clear confirmation of the truth of the gospel, the Philippians had not abandoned him. Serving the Lord can get lonely at times. It can be hard because more times than not, the truth for us this morning is that we really aren't in the majority. Sure, we live in a culture where it's okay to say that you're a Christian. But that really doesn't bear a lot of weight today. Doesn't mean very much to say that you're a Christian, because a lot of people hold that banner and they profane the name of Christ. There are a lot of churches who say, we're a Christian church, but the things that they do and the things that they say are far from anything that Christ has given us in His Word. Being a Christian, if we really open our eyes, that can be lonely. When you start to affirm what the Bible says, when you say that Jesus is the only way to salvation, things can get pretty quiet. But what an encouragement when we look on the lives of those who are serving the Lord faithfully, both here and worldwide. We can be assured that Christ is building His church. And so Paul shares three A's, not triple A, three A's, all right? Three A's that would be pertinent for these Philippian people. As he continues in verse 8, these things will be important for us as well. He remarks of the deep affection that he had for his fellow believers in Philippi. Paul had a deep affection for his brothers and sisters in Christ. I want us to take for a moment just to consider the love with which Paul loved these people. As he dealt with many pangs and different trials, Paul rejoiced in the work that Christ was doing in his church amongst the believers there. And as he recounted this, he said he had affection for them. But this was not just any kind of affection. All right, this wasn't elementary school when, the boy gives a Valentine's Day card to his crush. And we say, oh, how affectionate, right? That's sweet. That's puppy love, right? This wasn't, what's that?
Real to the puppy.
Real to the puppy, yeah. There you go. All right, this isn't that kind of affection that you have with your animals at home. Like our dog, when you think the dog really, really likes you, until you find out that the reason she can't stop looking at you is because there's a big pile of cookies right behind your back, right? That's not the kind of love and affection that Paul had for his brothers and sisters. I mean, those things are okay. I don't know. I think our dog likes us, but man, Paul loved the church in Philippi way more than that. Way more. He loved his brothers and sisters there, and his affection was far deeper than that which we mentioned prior. Such an analogy of a boy in elementary school or a dog doesn't even begin to touch the affection that Paul had. When Paul uses this word here, the word in the Greek is splachon, which is far deeper than any dog can experience for its owner. This is a love that comes deep from the bowels, the intestines, the heart. This is a love that has a mutual connection here that can only be created by the work of the Savior. We know that in John 13:35, Jesus says, by this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. But I want you to think for a moment about the reality of the love that should be in the church. The love we share with one another should be so much different than what the world knows. It's instilled by God. You see, this type of affection for the Philippian people cannot be experienced apart from Christ. This love, this affection that Paul had for these people was so deep in his heart that it had to be put there by somebody else. This wasn't something that Paul had conjured up. This was an affection far greater than any Valentine's Day card could show, than any dog kiss can tell you. This was a love and affection that went beyond human comprehension, that caused for Paul to constantly feel this desire to share with them in the grace, to communicate with them of the grace that God has placed them in, that God has provided for them. Paul loved the Philippians, and he cared so deeply about them and the work that God was doing there in their midst. And this was the result of receiving grace upon grace, being made new creations in our Lord and being brought into a new family. Paul shared a new connection with these Philippian believers from the day that those people were saved. They were knitted together by the enduring work of Christ. The church should really be marked by such affection, a love and compassion that transcends what the world can understand. That we should be so knitted together that by the work of God, it would flow from our mouths with a love that is radical. You know, a lot of times we like to talk, and it's good, about sharing the gospel with the world. And those are good things, showing compassion, love, kindness, doing missions work, caring for people on the outside, trying to make known the gospel of Jesus Christ. After all, we are commanded to do that. But we get it so backwards sometimes because we do that, but then people look on the church and all they hear about is hypocrisy, a dog-eat-dog world, church politics. Man, what if people heard about us? Man, those people, they're weird over there at First Baptist Church. They really love each other. It's kind of strange, but I want it. I want it. If we started with that, this kind of affection that Paul had for these people, man, on Tuesday, were you thinking, I can't wait to see Pastor on Sunday? That's okay. I don't always think it about you. Most times I do. But here's what's so important for us as believers. We should have that kind of affection. Paul says he yearned for his brothers and sisters in Philippi. He yearned for them. He had an affection that came from his bowels. Why? Not because this was something he desired and kind of worked up on his own. No, because he was brought into the family of God as we read that story of Paul's encounter. And so he was saved there. And then later on, the Philippian church is saved. And because of that, they were knitted together with an affection that was deep. Was deep. We should examine ourselves to see if that kind of affection is in us. Do we have that kind of love for one another? If not, I believe we can pray. We should pray regardless, but we can pray what Paul prayed. Paul loved his brothers and sisters and longed for them with a deep and countercultural love. And he, in verse 9, says this: "It is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment. Paul prayed that their love would abound. As Paul loved his brothers and sisters in Philippi, so too did he desire and pray that their love would abound more and more. Now, let me tell you, this morning, and we had a time of study and prayer back in the, was it the fall or maybe the spring here on Wednesday nights. We talked about refining our prayer life. And I want to encourage for us this morning, this is a prayer that we should start praying if we don't already. You know, sometimes we say, I don't know what to pray. I don't know. What do I say? Verse 9 of Philippians chapter 1. If you're at a loss for words, that's a pretty amazing thing that you could pray for the people in our church or elsewhere in other churches, that our love may abound more and more. And in this, Paul prayed that the believers would continue to be equipped in the love of God and to have it overflow in their hearts as they served together. Paul recognized that such a love is not of this world. Now, why do I say that? Well, I'm not the only one to take note of this here. But Paul specifically says that there is a prayer connected to that love. Well, that tells us this morning that that love only comes from one place. Comes from the Lord. Paul recognized that. He notes that it flows from our God and comes from His hands alone. The term used here for love is that of a exceeding in measure, that abounding exceeds in measure. It's a filling up with more that still remains. We must remember once again who sets the standard for what that love is. It's God. This agape love that we actually studied back at Christmas time, love that is from God, is not the kind of counterfeit love that we see people sharing today. No, God's love is in full agreement with His Word and transcends in a way that is consistent with what He has taught us. In Paul's prayers for his brothers and sisters, he desired earnestly to see them abound with this godly love that would keep them knitted together as they served with a unity that would contrast from the world. God's love is different. People today, they'll say, you might have heard it before, love is love. I say, well, God's love is love. But this other kind of love you're talking about is garbage. It's garbage. It's not love at all. All you do is holding hands, worshiping yourselves. But God's love is so vastly different. And Paul's love for his people here, his brothers and sisters in Philippi, was one that abounded, and he prayed the same for them, that the love that they would have for one another would overflow, exceed beyond measure. And finally, in verse 10, he says, so that you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. In addition to abounding in this love, Paul prayed that the believers would be given knowledge and discernment. Knowledge and discernment. This refers to us this morning. It's really a true understanding of what God's word says. So often today we have churches who only stop at studying the milk of the word, the basics of truth. And those things are so vastly important, but we are called to go deeper. We're not called to stop at the surface level. And elsewhere in Scripture, we see a prayer that the people would be able to take the meat of the word, go beyond the milk, dig deeper into Scripture. Here, Paul expounds on the marvelous reality of what happens when we immerse ourselves in the Word of God, that love abounding must be attached to knowledge and all discernment. That abounding love must be connected to a knowledge of the Word. Why do we study and seek to understand God's Word? See, I don't know why we need to get into all of this. Well, because it provides us with a practical understanding of His truth so that we may put it into action from day to day. It's so important for us to know the Word, to be in lockstep with Scripture so that we may, as Paul says here, approve what is excellent and be in alignment with God's teachings. And when we say that we're committed to the Word, as we've said throughout this year, that includes this reality. We're going to dig deeper because when we do, we are able to gain insight into how to handle life's difficulties. When Paul uses the word approve in this passage, he's saying that knowing God's word allows us to examine and understand that which is in accordance with it. When we dig deeper and we see how Scripture is interwoven, when we understand how one passage relates to another, when we practice sound study, not taking Scripture out of context, but letting it speak for itself, it will play out in our lives. But we must be immersed, praying that God would make His word clear to us. You'll see there up on the screen this morning, a love for God will ultimately, I mean this without compromise, it will lead you to an immersion in His Word. And an immersion in His Word will lead you to an understanding of His Word. And that doesn't mean we'll understand everything. But we should desire to know as much as God has revealed to us. You say, well, I love God, but I don't have time. I don't have the time to spend in His Word from day to day. Guess what? I don't know how much you love God. And I know for me, as I consider marriage, and frankly, what's fascinating is, I don't know what it is, but this baby, man, I'm already like so filled with love for this kid. You tell her that one day. But I'm excited to be with our child. Every now and then she gives me a good kick on the hand. She's going to be a sassy one. But I want to be with this baby. For me, I love Ashley. I want to be with her. But so often people say, I love God. But man, they don't spend any time with Him. That doesn't jive. Oh, I love God. I'm a Christian, but I don't go to church from week to week. I am the church. No, you're not. We are the church. It's the body. We all have different functions. A love for God will always translate into you wanting to be immersed in His Word, to be in fellowship, when possible, with His people. And in doing that, what's so cool is that God uses His Word to change us, to affect us, to transform us, so that we might have the ability in this crazy, messed up, wacky world, we might have the ability to discern right and wrong. Because it's all right here. People say, we talked about this on Wednesday nights, the Bible, it's not black and white, it's gray. I say, no, the Bible's black and white. But sin has made a lot of things really gray. And so we need the Bible to make sense of what is right and what is wrong. Paul's prayer for these people. These people in Philippi, as they endured and sought to faithfully serve, was that they would abound in love for one another, and that through God's word, they would become knowledgeable and be able to discern as their love for Him pushes them into communion with Him in the study of His word regularly. We've been given a marvelous gift of salvation that we've received in Jesus Christ, but there is so much that flows from that precious gift. Paul was experiencing it in his walk, seeing that affection for his beloved brothers and sisters, praying that it would abound in a way that unbelievers simply could not fathom. And as we come together here today, might we be ones who yearn for God to continually refresh us in His love and to cause it to overflow, that we might exhibit it as we live today. Might we yearn for God to give us a hunger for His word, that we might align with it and grow in it. Because situations arise from day to day that surely test us, but there is no better guide in those moments than the Holy Spirit working through His word, causing us to have clarity in moments of fogginess. May God be glorified in us, His people, as we seek to understand His word and to care for one another with love that is like unlike anything that this world will see in material things. And let us pray for one another, maybe this specific prayer as you pray, that the love of God might spring from our hearts, and that we would grow in all knowledge and discernment as we seek His face. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are humbled by Your great love for us. It's marvelous what You've done for us. Our prayer this morning is that our love would abound for one another and that we would have knowledge and discernment as we study Your word, immerse ourselves in it. Might You increase our knowledge of truth. God, we thank You. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand with us as we close our time together this morning and singing hymn number 382, Be Thou My Vision. Lord, would you be our vision as we go from here, direct our paths, cause for your love to abound in our hearts that it might exceed and overflow without measure, Lord. We thank you for the love you've placed in us, and we ask that it might sustain us as we go from here. And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you unblemished in his glorious presence with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord before all time, and now and for all eternity. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.